Hello and welcome to EC Council Certified DevSecOps Engineer Training. In this particular training, we are going to talk about what DevOps operations are, how developers are able to integrate security in the DevOps cycle, collectively making it as DevSecOps, and what individual operations, functionalities, or processes would you need to include in your current process, in your current environment, in order to become more inclined towards the security of the finalized outcome, that is softwares or websites. Okay. This side, Dipanshu, I'll be a trainer through this course. And before I start going through the content, let me start by a small description about myself. So I have been a cybersecurity instructor since January 2018, giving me a good amount of time to understand the concepts and explaining what security are, what security concepts are, what cybersecurity primarily includes. I've been associated with Koenig Solutions since January 2021. And I have been certified in many contents. Some of them are mentioned here, like the Certified Ethical Hacker, the Certified Application Security Engineer. .NET is preferred as before joining as a cybersecurity instructor. I was a full-stack web developer operating in the .NET environment. So C# was my primary language. And ASP.NET MVC was the framework that I was usually operating on. So I've been providing training for multiple vendors for multiple certifications like EC Council, CompShare, Offensive Security, and many more. Some of the skills that I usually train for are highlighted here. As you can see, majority of them are EC Council. That is because I'm a registered EC Council certified instructor. That gives me the authority to deliver trainings on behalf of EC Council for any official courses which I have been certified for. I have delivered trainings for multiple organizations, multiple countries, so state governments, central governments, some MNCs. You can see the list is a bit long. Skipping that, these are some feedbacks that some of my past students have provided for me. This is all from the previous 3 months. That's kind of how we operate. And this has been my area of operations for operating inside Koenig Solutions. Now, being a full stack developer myself, I can clearly understand the role, the operations, the processes that we usually follow while developing for an organization or for a particular client. And that is what I will be trying to inculcate in explaining how security concepts or security behavior can be introduced in your generalized or your normally operated day-to-day operations when you are trying to develop a new product, software, or any particular web service for the client or even for your own organization. We'll be discussing about certain tools, certain techniques for how to evaluate your content, how to evaluate your environment. In this particular course, they have given practical operations, practical approaches for multiple vendors, primarily focusing on on-premises environment and cloud environment. That's the major segregation. For on-premises, they have given some tools and techniques. For on-cloud, they have given references for AWS and Azure primarily. So you'll be seeing too many contents being described twice or thrice from different perspective based on different environment. It can be on-prem or either one of the cloud, that is AWS and Azure. Now, without wasting much time, let's move ahead on the content. I hope you are able to see my screen.
Yes.
Right. So first of all, welcome to this EC consultation for a certified DevSecOps engineer. I'll discuss about examination a little bit, and then
We'll simply proceed towards the content. Okay.
Okay.
So when we start with DevSecOps engineer, your exam is not too much lengthy. First of all, there are only 7 modules, out of which 5 are for each individual stage of DevSecOps operation. So planning stage, coding stage, build and test stage, release and deploy, and operate and monitor. All stages are included of the DevOps, including the security part inside it. Okay. Module 1 is understanding the DevOps as a culture, and module 2 is introduction to the DevSecOps. So the content is pretty much straightforward. Now, the examination is a 4-hour MCQ examination, 100 MCQs in total. And to be honest, the examination was pretty much easy. Once you go through the content, the examination is pretty straightforward. Okay. So this is basically the iLabs environment where you can launch your labs, use them for all types of operations. Okay. Other than this, you have access to the ebook on the Aspen website. So, okay, no issues. Now we are good to go. Since you are already having access to the labs, so what we'll be doing is we'll be covering up theoretical aspect here, and then I'll ask you to pop up your labs and you'll be doing the things, the operations on your side.
Okay.
Now, starting with module 1, understanding DevOps culture. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Now, first of all, this is something that you already mentioned, that you have seen the transition from SDLC to DevOps, right?
Yes.
And now we are shifting from DevOps to DevSecOps. So initially, the DevOps was introduced so that we can have a faster and more reliable form of development, or a method of development, making sure that our needs, does not matter how much dynamic they are always satisfied, right? SDLC was more or less like a static process, whereas DevOps became more dynamic into the environment. And then as we started feeling the need of security in our infrastructure, we tried to put security as an overlaying layer, as an additional layer on top of the applications. Eventually, we started finding out the need of security being integrated into the development environment, and that is where we found the DevSecOps. Okay. Now, so, and we are going to understand the evolution of software development lifecycle, the SDLC process. So the most common SDLC method or SDLC model that we know of is waterfall model, right? Waterfall was this step-by-step approach. You operate on one process or one operation at a time, and eventually reaching out to the finalized version. Agile tried to be feedback-oriented. Right. For Agile, I have one referential model, which is referred as prototype model. Have you heard about prototype model?
I've heard of it. Yeah.
So prototype model usually had this approach where they will develop a product and they will be receiving a feedback and they'll be getting back into the development of it. So this went on as a cycle. So Agile was inspired from that, whereas DevOps basically said, tried to integrate everything in form of continuous integration, continuous delivery, deployment. So in short, DevOps was feeding towards continuous optimization, whereas your SDLC was more of a one iteration operation, right?
Mm-hmm.
So waterfall model, we are already aware about these phases: requirement analysis, system design, implementation, system testing, system deployment and maintenance. So each step was referred as a phase, and we know, in just like the waterfall, these phases are not in or not arranged in a cyclic manner. So once a project goes through this whole operation, through this whole model, then the project cannot just directly iterate back. It has to be coming up as a separate project or a new version of the project, right? Which makes it quite difficult for us since we are not having the ability of continuous integrations. In IT environment, in our digital environment, we have faced ever-changing demands. We are seeing that almost every day we are facing with new difficulties, new challenges, hence new requirements. And waterfall model or SDLC in general was not having that similar ability.
Right.
So it is difficult to implement changes. Project delivery is delayed as not a prototype is created. And it invokes risk. It is difficult to identify challenges with risk in advance because testing is performed at a later stage. Agile method. This was the iterative software development approach. Agile basically, as I said, it took the derivation from the prototyping model, where the development is going to be quite related with the feedback of the previous deployment. Okay, so you gather the analysis requirements, develop the operations. So code, test, deploy, and after that, whatever feedback is going to come, we will integrate that and put it back into the development environment. So each iteration follows the waterfall model in terms of requirement gathering, analysis, deployment, testing, and maintenance. The only thing, this was done in a cyclic manner, and feedback was a very big part of it. Now, agile method gave us the ability to have good interactions, good ability of feedback. But it was not suitable for complex applications. We cannot always have a feedback for one aspect and then put the whole project into development, right? So this was one of the issues or challenges in the Agile, that even a smaller modification, smaller update would require the whole project to be undergoing the development phase and redevelopment phase, which made it quite inefficient. So either you have to collect multiple feedbacks before the project goes into development, or as soon as you receive a feedback, you have to quickly develop the finalized version because there are going to be other feedbacks as well. In either way, we are either overworking our resources or we are keeping the issues waiting in line before they are resolved. Okay. So yep. this relies on client understanding of the requirement. And as it mentions in point four, the product is tested only at the developer system, not in production server. Developer system is a small scale environment. Right. Now, we usually do not test anything in the production environment.
Right.
But what we can do is have a production like simulation where we might be testing the application rather than just on the developer system. This is something that we usually call as the test bed, right?
Mm-hmm.
It is deployed like the production. It is operated like the production. The only thing, it is not the exact production server. Then came the DevOps methodology. DevOps is another extension of Agile. Basically saying the integration of the process or of the feedback is going to be faster. The reason for that is you are going to have good amount of integration capability. So advantage of DevOps, they have given you point by point. Constant communication between teams. Fewer software failures caused by the differences in infrastructure. Fast production of new infrastructure, increased test automation, quick and reliable delivery of application updates, fewer post-release errors, and improved user trust, all because there was a good integration between the development environment and the operational environment. That's why collectively it was referred as DevOps. Okay. And also DevOps, if it is a new project, DevOps is a lengthy and time-consuming process. Mm-hmm. Okay. But once a project is developed, then its maintenance is going to be much easier because now you do not have to go through the whole cycle. Like in Waterfall, they had just one single iteration, design, code, and then at the end, you had the test. In case of Agile, they tried to put test in bit intermediate because of the multiple cycles. In DevOps, the test was so closely integrated with the code that every functionality that we are developing is being verified by the operational department. Okay, this satisfies the requirement. There can be few changes and all. So operational department is continuously verifying this. Along with that, testing of the code is also helping us in maintaining a structured flow of the operations. So by the time you deploy, your application is still very readily available to be updated again. Okay.
So that just tells me that the program that I worked for previously, they did Agile, not DevOps, when I thought it was the...
See,
interesting.
Agile and DevOps, it is very hard to distinguish.
It is, okay. Yeah.
The reason for that is DevOps has been taking its inspirations from Agile. Mm-hmm. The only difference that you will find is that in case of DevOps, you will be having continuous communications and feedbacks for each of the modules that we have, that we create. Okay, I'll give you a basic example. Whenever a web application is developed, web application is divided in multiple small modules. So there is some static content that goes to a specific team. Then in dynamic, there is going to be a login mechanism. There is internal panels, payment gateways, however many types of operations there are, each of them is going to be divided between teams or as separate modules. Now, in case of Agile, they will have one development of all the modules, take a feedback and quickly develop it again. In case of DevOps, each module is developed and parallelly it is verified with the operations team, that whether its operation, its functioning is the correct as required or not. Okay. Now, operations team does not necessarily mean you are going to call someone from outside. Okay. Mm-hmm. Or someone outside of the development team. There have been operations, there have been organizations. What they do is they develop use cases for each module based on whatever requirements they have gathered from the operational team. Okay. And then they test for the use cases. This is something that you might have seen in your environment, that they have been working with use cases, not asking other individuals, but they have developed use cases based on the requirement and lists. And they are continuously using that use cases to verify the proper functionality of your developed modules. So that is also DevOps,
okay,
not Agile. Okay, in Agile, everything is developed and then it is tested.
Yep.
Okay. So, DevOps gives the organization ability to generate robust quality software products and services at a faster pace. Now, they are not saying that whole development process is going to be faster. They are saying a quality product is going to be developed faster. Now, what is the difference in a faster development and a quality product being developed faster?
So you're getting out, you know, something that works faster instead of waiting until the end and everything's developed, and you know, you're pushing it out and testing it more frequently. So you're getting those fixes out to the customer much quicker.
Right. So when we are just focusing on faster development, we are only focusing on the functional ability and not the ability of that application to fully support the user processes or the user requirement, which is something which eventually results in some form of damage at the client's end, at the after the deployment. Okay. And this is why sometimes projects fail quite often. When we talk about faster and robust development, when we are saying robust, that means it has already been tested for too many things, too many errors, too many issues, which means you can throw anything at that and it is going to be much more durable, much more reliable, rather than something which has been tested after completion. I'll give you a simplest example. You're using a cell phone, right? And my assumption is you're using an iPhone. Am I correct?
Yes.
Yes. Now, other than security, what other factor do you think iPhone is going to provide you, which Android does not?
Ease of use.
Ease of use. Android is having ease of use. It's just what you get adapted to. That's not the part. What other things do you think there is?
Efficiency. Yeah.
Okay. Have you used Android earlier? I'm assuming you were a Samsung user which switched to Android.
Yeah.
I don't know, for some very weird reasons, 40% of the time that is the case. Yeah. Samsung users switching to iPhone.
Right.
So what difference did you found other than the operational, like how you use, other than the user interface? What other things was there that iPhone gave that Samsung was not able to do?
FaceTime.
FaceTime. Okay. Agreed. Even though Android has Google Duo, Google Meet.
Right. So, yeah, it's not as efficient.
Yeah. What else?
It's less user-friendly, I would say.
Android is the most customizable operating system. You can make as much user-friendly as you want. Okay. Now, see. The major differences between Android and iPhone is that iPhone is optimized for its own environment. Okay. So once you become part of that environment, once you get inside that environment, you will find iPhone is the best. Because all of the infrastructure, MacBook, iPhone, AirPads, iPad, your iWatch, all of that infrastructure is collectively developed by one organization, is running on the operating system provided by one vendor who has customized it for that environment, that ecosystem only, right? Yeah. So that gives you the ability to interact inside that environment, but outside that environment, you face dependency issues, right?
Yep.
If I remember correctly, for a longest period of time, iPhone did not have the Bluetooth. You were only using the Apple Share or using Gmail or mailing services to share files or data, which is pretty extensive. In Android, Bluetooth was already available. So even if we did not had good internet access, we were still having the ability to connect via Bluetooth. And that is just one of the features. Okay. Now, one of the things that people have said that iPhone is water resistant. There are Android phones as well, which are water resistant. iPhone 14, I'm not sure about others, but iPhone 14 has been said to be way much durable. That even if gets dropped, it's not going to crack easily. Mm-hmm. Right? But when we talk about the strongest phones, the durable phones, no device can beat the legacy of Nokia. at some point you must have used Nokia.
Oh yeah. Yeah.
Right. I still remember my first 3310, the strongest phone in the world. Still, Nokia is providing still very durable phones. So Nokia, that organization's primary objective is you buy a device once, use it for multiple years, then discard it. So by the time you discard it, they have developed new devices. Okay, so it basically gives way much time to the manufacturer. Whereas if we talk about the cheaper versions, anything under $300, in case of Android, those are temporary usage phones. You use them for a couple of months, might be 1 or 2, 1.5 years, then they are useless. Right? So it,
yeah,
all of it becomes on how good the operations have been, how much they have invested in verifying the quality, the usability of individual modules before they have compiled up the whole device and provided it to you. Okay. So in case of Apple, they have developed their whole ecosystem, giving them the edge. Everything that they develop, they are going to use. And anything that their environment, their ecosystem does not support is no longer part of their ecosystem, making it more and more useful and challenging as well. Other organizations cannot compete until and unless they set up their own ecosystem. Okay. Now, compared to that, in case of Android, you find many variants for the same thing. There are Android device providers who have, they have less credibility on their robustness. They are cheap, easy to use, and easy to discard as well. Okay. They're not suitable for long-term use. In DevOps, that was the major part. You have the development, you have the operations, and quality is always assured. That's why we are always focusing on the robustness of the output product. The development, we are trying to be in modules, trying to keep the development in form of modules, making your development environment more and more segregated so that all the development can run parallelly. Okay. Because of the parallel development in form of individual modules, it becomes quite easy to use and faster to develop. Each module is going to be tested, so quality assurance is quite integrated in that environment. So DevOps have tried to come up with a solution which gives you the faster pace with a robust quality of the products. Okay. Now, most of the people think DevOps is only for software products. That is not true. Okay. Now, like the SDLC concept, the concept of SDLC. We have seen SDLC as software development lifecycle, right? Have you ever heard about system development lifecycle?
Yeah.
And PDLC, that is product development lifecycle.
I don't think I've heard that one.
So PDLC is another approach of using lifecycle, but in a different context.
Okay.
Okay. So product manufacturers use PDLC. And this is something that I studied because my background comes from a management layer. Okay. I did my graduation in computer application, which is majorly focusing on how computer is useful in multiple domains rather than what computers are. Okay. So I have this variety of fields experience, knowledge regarding their operations. And that's how I came across PDLC. PDLC and both SDLC, that is software development and system development lifecycles.
Okay.
Okay. So wherever there is development, there is going to be DevOps or SDLC. whether they are referred by the same name or might be a different name. Okay. Now, they have mentioned DevOps helps in effective collaboration and cooperation among previously siloed roles such as development, IT operations, quality engineering, and security to deliver secure and reliable software products quickly. And this is where my primary question comes. If they have already mentioned security in DevOps, what was the need of DevSecOps? What do you think?
Was it where it was being placed, maybe? Instead of maybe, you know, it should be in the beginning in development, maybe it was being introduced later on in the cycle?
Not necessarily, actually, all of the development that we were having via DevOps. Theoretically, the development, the coding process, the testing process, they were testing for security approaches as well. Okay.
Okay.
And this is where the issue relies. They are only testing the code for security vulnerabilities or loopholes. According to them, they never considered the logical flaw, the business logic flaw, or even misunderstanding of the requirements as a security risk. Okay. So rather than having security integrated at all levels, the security integrated in DevOps was only at the coding and testing stage.
Okay.
Okay. So they were able to generate good security products, good products with good level of security, but not the most efficient security. That's why we have the need of DevSecOps. Now, main goal of DevOps methodology: low error rate, achieve business and customer requirements, enhance productivity, manage interaction between different departments, optimize deployment and tasks, improve strategies and programs, improve strategies. Wow. They're focusing on strategy and program twice. Must have been a typing error. And a faster feedback. Benefits of DevOps: good speed, whether it is for development or deployment. One of the good things that agile methodology actually introduced in development was the consumption of pre-developed modules. Okay. So this is something that earlier used to happen in case of SDLC. If we talk purely theoretically, in case of SDLC, all the code will be developed from the scratch. Okay. Which majorly increases time if the code that you're developing, it is something similar to your previous or some separate project development, and it is a challenging operation. Like the most common one is integrating payment gateway in a website, right? So when integrating payment gateway was the issue, developing the code from the scratch was going to be a challenge. Hence, in case of agile development, what we started doing was, for specific operation, we started saving codes, code snippets. And whenever required, we will use that code snippet. The only requirement, or should I say the only restriction, was that the code snippet should be for a general operation rather than for some highly specific operation, which is someone's either intellectual property or which holds someone's identity or operational or business details inside it. So if that code is not there, then we can consume the same code from other projects. So this made your development quite faster. Now, if I talk in real time, developers is a, because I have been a developer, I usually say developers is the most lazy breed of IT individuals. Okay. Have you seen that? Developers are the most lazy breed of IT individuals.
I haven't seen that, no.
I can clearly say this because I have been a developer and I know how development operation runs. So I'll tell you about the operations in development that most of the organizations are doing nowadays. First is copy-pasting the code from this support websites. Like the there is the SourceForge, there are some like Stack Overflow or some support websites where they are sharing codes for generalized operation. They're directly copy-pasting from that. Okay. Second, they're collaborating with colleges. And what they're saying, we'll give you internship certificate. Whatever project, college project you are going to do, they give them a topic. The students develop the code. They take the code as their intellectual property, and then they use that code. For the students, they give them internship certificate for like 2 weeks or 1 month internship if they find the code useful. And the third one, which is the biggest scam, I would say, when they're hiring freshers, they're giving unrealistic projects. Like I remember one, they gave a front-end website, like a dynamic generated web page. And they asked all the applicants, because all of them were freshers, they asked them, you have to develop this with a certain technology, certain language. And if you can develop this and you submit the code, that code becomes our intellectual property. You cannot claim that this is your own. And then we will consider you for the next round. Can you imagine having this kind of operation in any other area, any other domain?
Maybe manufacturing. I'm not sure, but I've never been in that space. So.
No.
Yeah.
No one is having that kind of operations. This is something that, because I have been training for security and my past as a developer, I still have some of my friends in the same domain. And they tell me this shamelessly. They're like, we haven't written a single line of code in like years.
Yeah.
And what we do is find out the requirement. Okay. Go to the campus hiring, college hiring, hire freshers, give them these unrealistic projects, like aspects of the project. They will develop it. If the code works, good. If the code does not work, we give them the errors. And senior developers are more or less like a small team manager who is just getting interns to work for him. And he's just using that part.
Yeah.
So that's why I'm saying developers have become the most lazy breed of IT individuals now. Okay. Now, because of the DevOps as a cycle, they have lower deployment failures because after each module is developed, each stage is developed, they are testing it according to the use cases or according to the requirements. And this helps in easy identification, rectification of errors. Okay. Once you have removed all the errors that are there in the code at each individual module level, the only errors that can develop in the whole project are due to integration. Right? When you are integrating a couple of modules and you have tested each module separately and removed all the errors from the modules, the only possible errors come from the integration of the modules. Mm-hmm. And that is where the finalized testing usually happens. So finalized testing of the complete project is no longer focusing on all types of issues, rather only the integration issues. So by the time the project is deployed, all the module-based errors are removed, and any errors, any issues that might have arisen due to integration have already been tested for. So you have rectified the application or the project too many times for it to fail. Okay. And if it is still failing, that means either your requirement analysis was not sufficient, that you have not taken into account the deployment phase or the deployment hardware, or your testing was not sufficient. Okay. So it also gives you the ability to find out where your process was lacking. Improve efficiency. With automation, the time required for developers to perform automated tasks is reduced, helping improve their efficiency. And nowadays, we have the integration of ChatGPT and similar environments.